Welcome to the Affordable High Performance Home Series. Howdy y'all, I'm Jordan Smith. I'm a design builder here in Austin, Texas, and I've been designing, building, and remodeling homes for about the last 20 years. Over the last several years, I've been focusing on high-end, high-performance homes, and one of the top comments I get back on all my social media channels that I'm posting this stuff on is like, man, it would be nice if I had $1 million or $2 million or $5 million to build a high-performance home. I would do that too, but I don't, so I guess I can't. It made me wonder, is high performance and expensive the same thing? Or can you build a high performance home that is also affordable? In this series, we are going to attempt to build an affordable high performance home. Let's define what it means when we say affordable. Affordable doesn't mean as cheap as possible. Affordable means, can we build a home that is similar in cost to a production-built home in the same neighborhood? Here in Austin and the surrounding areas, $500,000 is a pretty healthy budget for a production home. You can spend a lot more, you can spend a little bit less, but we're setting that as the budget for affordable. It's a lot of money, it's the world we live in. Everything is a lot of money. And when we say high performance, we're looking at four things. It's gotta be beautiful, it's gotta be comfortable, it's gotta be resilient, and it's got to be sustainable. Beautiful, because if we build an ugly house, the next generation is going to tear it down. If you look at the historic homes that we take care of as a society, they are beautiful homes. They're homes that people put a lot of thought in the design, a lot of craftsmanship into the build. You can tell when you walk in there that humans have spent part of their lives creating this thing, and us as fellow humans see that, appreciate it, and want to take care of that. If you walk into a home that just feels like it was thrown up as quickly as possible, even if it's a resilient home or a high performance home, but it's just ugly and cold and austere, future generations aren't going to want to take care of that, and they'll end up tearing it down and rebuilding something. So if we want it to be resilient, we've got to make it beautiful. It's also got to be comfortable. That can be a number of things like thermal comfort, insulation, HVAC. It can be health. We want to have healthy air. We want to have pure water. We want to thrive in the places that we live. And it could also be the way that the house is positioned on the lot. You have great sunrises. You want to see that sunrise through great windows. Maybe you have an epic view out to the north. You want to cant the house to where you have that view. Thinking about all of these things to make it where the humans living in it are comfortable and they're inspired to live the best lives that they can live. And so if you make a beautiful and a comfortable house, the humans are going to be really, really happy in there. But if it's not resilient and it burns down at the first fire, or it blows away in the hurricane or tornado, or the ice storm comes through and you lose power and the whole house is unlivable for several weeks, that doesn't do the humans living in it any good either. We've got to build resilient homes. Natural disasters are on the rise. We see it in the news everywhere. So if you're building somewhere that you know there's a proclivity for that natural disaster, we've got to build a house that is built to withstand that natural disaster. And then finally, it's got to be sustainable. I don't mean that it has to be fully self-sustainable, but we need to be moving in the direction of fully self-sustaining. So for this series, we're looking at a net zero home, a home that is producing as much power as it uses every year. Doesn't mean that it does it every day. You may be pulling from the grid for part of the time, but over the course of a year, it's producing the same amount of power that it uses. It's taking care of its own sewage, and we have a strategy for getting off of the water grid if necessary. So the house needs to be able to sustain itself if a natural disaster comes through and takes out one of the critical grids supplying that house. It needs to be able to continue to support the people living inside of it. I'm super excited about this series. We're going to get into all of the details on what makes this version of the high performance house. So make sure that you subscribe so you don't miss any of the good episodes coming up. Comment below if you have any ideas on how to make an affordable high performance home better, and join us next time as we endeavor to build better.